Lord, we just invite your presence here. We thank you for being here, Lord. We thank you for being in us. And we just want to worship you this morning in spirit and in truth. And Lord, as people are coming in this morning, let us just enter into worship with joy and thanksgiving and praise and with hearts of abandon for you, Lord. Thank you that you love us. And Lord, we just want to enjoy your love for us this morning. We just want to love on you, Lord, because you're our Father and we're your children. Thank you, Lord. Come inhabit our praise. as we worship you this morning, let us just worship you as a child, Lord. Let us come to you. You said come to you as children, Lord, in simplicity and purity of devotion to Christ. So, Lord, we just come to you as your kids, as your children, just longing for the love of a father, Lord, delighting in the love of our father. And, Lord, we just love you back because you love us first. And, Lord, we just thank you for what you're going to do here among us this morning, and we invite you to have your way in us, Lord. Whatever's in us that needs to be just taken away, Lord, that needs to be simplified in our life, Lord. Whatever things we're hanging on to this morning that are keeping us from feeling your love, Lord, we just release those right now. We lay them down at your feet, Lord. We lay down our fear. We lay down our doubt and our unbelief. We lay down our unforgiveness, Lord. Anything that we're hanging on to this morning, we just lay it at your feet right now in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your joy and your strength, God, that are ours because of the cross. Thank you for your blood, Lord. Thank you that you broke the power of sin, that we can worship you in faith. Thank you, Lord. Above all kings. Jesus, who love me. You poured out all your blood. You died upon the cross. Jesus, how we love your presence, how we love to worship you. Lord, there's no greater joy than just to worship you, Lord. It's when we worship you that we're right where we were created to be. You created us to worship you, to have fellowship with you, to be your friends. Lord, thank you that we can be your friends, that we can be your sons and daughters. Lord, that everything that we need or want or desire, it's all found in you, Jesus. All wrapped up in you. Thank you for your presence. We love you so much, Lord. We thank you for the cross. We thank you for salvation, for grace. And we do just want to worship you forever, Lord. Forever and eternity. Thank you that we get to do that. Enjoy your presence, Lord. That's all that really matters. In Jesus' name, amen.
Can we do one extra thing today? Today is what? Okay. God's our Father, right? What do you do on Father's Day? Honor, but we celebrate dads, don't we?
Okay.
Yeah, we have a party. We throw, you know, we take them out to dinner. We, you know, lavish them with gifts, and I'm available for gifts. And I'm kidding. But you know what? We're a little subdued today. You know, and we got into worship, which is great. But we got to celebrate. So we're going to do In Your Light one more time. But you got to stand up and celebrate dad. Okay? Can we do that? You ready for it? All right, let's do it.
Thank you.
Happy Father's Day, Lord. That was good.
Good morning. Happy Sunday. Happy Father's Day. So good to be together. For those of you that are visiting us for the first time, we're so glad you're here. And for those that of you that have been with us many times, it's so good to be together. Amen? Amen. You should have received a loop when you came in this morning. Looks something like this. There's a couple of things that we need to highlight that are going on. So, July 7th is a Sunday, and Rick and Ellen Coffin will be with us. They are the founding pastors here of the Marietta Vineyard. They are missionaries to India, and so they will be here sharing all of the fun stuff that God is doing in India, and so it's such a treat to be able to have them, so please plan on being here for that day. There is no study, no Marriage Without Regret study this coming Wednesday. There is no technically youth meeting because the youth and study are involved with VBS, Vacation Bible School, which starts today. Yay! Right. And Miss Julie will be up in just a second to give you all the details that you need. The other thing is we have Ronnie John's Beach Cafe dinner. The 22nd, be there, be square. You can see Rabbi Jay if you have any questions about that. And I'm going to ask Miss Julie to come up so that she can give you the details about VBS.
All right, VBS, tomorrow night, 5:30. We will feed your kids. Anyone who doesn't want your kids fed, let me know. No, you just come in and bring an alternate dinner. It's fine. Still eat with us because it's a lot of fun. We are, so that's exciting. We are fully staffed. If you wish to show up, still do. People get sick. You know, there's always, you will have a blast with us. I promise we're fun. And also, find some friends. Bring your kids' friends, if at all possible, because while we have a lot of adults and a lot of help, we don't have as many kids as I would like. Of course, I just want a million kids, but it would be great if you could, whomever you want, bring them. They will have the time of their life. And then next Sunday after VBS is kind of a wrap-up to VBS because we talk all week about standing strong for God. We are having what I have affectionately named the Healing Hoedown for Annie. I don't know if you remember this. It will forever be imprinted in my memory that she stood up here and she said, I'm going to need you to cowboy up your faith. Now, as a person who loves country and Western music, I thought that was a great way to say it. And it was imprinted on my mind. And I turned to whoever was sitting beside me. This is all over. We're going to have ourselves a cowboy up your faith party. And so it's called the Healing Hoedown. It's next Sunday directly after church. I would like for you to bring something Mexican cowboyish like to eat so that you can share. Ron's bringing all the steak. And so, no, kidding. But bring something, share, have a blast with us. Pray with her, bless her, because God really did a miracle, and I didn't want to miss it. Because although she was healed through doctors, she was healed by God. So we wanted to give him thanks and glory for that. And like I said, bring your kids all week. We are going to have just a fantastic time. Monday through Thursday, because I think there might be a wedding or something soon. Mm-hmm. And so... So anyway.
Well, amen. I still got whoa-oh in my head. So it's not a whoa-oh or an uh-oh, but it's offering time. Yay! It's offering time. Yay! All right. Good. Amen. If you got your offering with you, just if you want, hold it up. If you don't have anything monetarily to give this morning, put your hand on your heart, because that's the greatest gift. So, Lord, in Jesus' name, we offer to you not only our praise, but all we have. And, Lord, we give back to you, not because you demanded it of us, but because we love you. For, Lord, we give according to what you've spoken in our heart. So, Lord, we bless you with it. We ask that you use it and glorify it, multiply it. And we give it freely and heartfelt to you. And, Lord, I ask for those that are struggling finding a job, that, Lord, you bless them with a job this week. Lord, open doors that no man can shut, and close the doors that no man can open. Lord, those that are struggling financially and they need a better job, Lord, open doors, provide. Lord, miraculously, so that no one can say it was by their own hand, but by it was by your hand. We know that all we have comes from you. So we bless you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We got any testimonies today? Anything? Oh, yeah, we got a couple of them already. Cool.
You know, I hear people talk a lot of times, even you, Ron, about how God provides for us. And you say, like, you need to check for your school, and the exact amount showed up. And I kind of took it with a grain of salt, like, this doesn't happen. Well, this week, I got a bill from the IRS for about $1,100. And then I put the car in the shop Monday and spent $600 on the car. So that's like $1,700. Well, perfectly out of the blue, Thursday, I got a check in the mail for $1,700.
Yeah.
So praise God.
Fantastic. That's Jehovah Sneaky. I love it. Who else had a hand? April. Here you go, darling.
Hi there. For those of you who were here a while back, I gave my testimony about God healing me and then how I got arthritis in my finger. And it's gone.
Really? Amen. Woohoo! Fantastic. Who's got another one? We're on a roll today. Who? You, oh, okay, here, brother. Go ahead. Just talk. It's on.
Everyone have a big announcement to make. God and Jesus love you so. Amen.
Amen. Yeah. Thank you. Anybody else? One more. No one. Okay.
I just want to say that I am so grateful that the pastor did this series about the blood. And I, before I left to go be gone for 10 days, I bought the book in the bookstore that he suggested. And I just, my highlighter was just highlighting almost everything. And I just am so renewed in the realization of the power of the blood and what that blood does for you. And I've been trying to memorize a scripture every week because I don't memorize very well anymore. And this past week it was about how he took on all of our, he was smitten for our transgressions. And then the one line that just stuck out so to me, said he was chastised for our peace. And that's what I think Pastor Ron is saying to us. Just the blood. Jesus stands there no matter what Satan tries to do to take our peace away. And he says, I did it all. And there's not one more drop that needs to be shed. So I'm grateful for that. And I'm grateful that I got to share that with several people in Florida. And I just could tell that it was meaning something to them. And that just means that a message here can go further.
Amen. Same message. Amen. All righty. We got one more. Where's Kelly? Kel, here we go.
Just the kids? Can I have all the kids come on up? We're going to go ahead and dismiss them to their class. So VBS tomorrow night, 5:30. And the youth is going to be real involved doing the worship and some skits and fun stuff. So we're going to have a really good time together. Last year was amazing, and this year is going to be even better. So we're going to have fun with that. Just as they're coming up, just a quick little word about the kids. We still are in need of a couple of workers for the kids' classes, specifically the pre-K age, which is like the preschool and kindergarten class, 4 and 5 year olds. We are short a teacher in there, and there's a couple of needs here and there. So if any of you have been feeling nudged in the area of kids ministry, you are needed in there. And so just come see me after the service and I can get you set up to work in there. We have a really good time working with the kids. Don't feel like you're going to be in there missing out, because the Holy Spirit is in there, just like he's in here. And he's moving in the hearts of these kids. And it's really been amazing to see what he's doing in their lives this year. So come and see me if you'd like to sign up to help. We'd love to have you. Kids, if you want to, guys, want to stretch your hands out to the adults. And adults, let's bless the kids. Lord, we just thank you for these lives, Lord, that you are shaping and molding. And Lord, we thank you that we get to be a part in that, that we get to partner with you in that, Lord, as parents and just as a church body surrounding the parents that are bringing up these kids and your wisdom and your word. And God, we pray that this morning in the classes that you would move in power, that you would speak to these kids, Lord, that you would just move in their hearts, Lord, and draw them closer and closer to you, Lord, so that they might walk with you every day of their life, Lord. Put a hedge of protection around them and the workers as they're ministering to these kids. And we pray for a special blessing on the workers this morning, that you would touch them where they're at, Lord, that you would just surround them with your love and your presence and your peace. And we thank you for what you're going to do here this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. I love Nicholas. I'm so glad he's back. He knows who he is, and he's really okay with it. Yeah, it's fantastic. Do me a favor. Stand up and greet one another. Want to stand up and go for the wedding part, right? And just waltz. I did that on purpose today. I do everything on purpose. But now understand this. Let's start with a premise today, okay? We're looking at the godly father. Now, most fathers on Father's Day like freak out because they go, oh man, we're going to get bashed, okay? You know, how to be a godly father. Well, today we're going to talk about it. There's no bashing, but we're going to talk about it because our heavenly father made us an offer that we couldn't refuse. Not trying to be funny. I'm trying to be funny. Think about it. You're going, well, yeah, we can. Yeah, do we have a choice to refuse it? Yeah, but it's so wonderful that I'm believing that most everyone in this congregation this morning didn't refuse. It was a wonderful offer saying, I love you. And the neat part about it, just like, you know, they call The Godfather the ultimate man movie, which I disagree with because I think it's pretty vulgar on some of it. I saw it many years ago, and I don't think I've seen it since. But they call it the ultimate man movie because, you know, men are men in this movie, and the women love them for it, okay, supposedly. But think about it. What is the Godfather? He's the one that's ahead over the whole family, right? So God is ahead over all of us. It says we derive our name from him, it says in the scriptures. So he's our father. But here's the thing. Most men, if we probably, at least in my generation, most of us, a good portion of us, came from broken homes. So there was really most likely no father around. And unfortunately, if you watch, how many of you watch TV today, you know, in our time? I mean, you've got TV at your home and you watch it. How do they make the dads look in most of the sitcoms? Like idiots, right? And the moms are the ones that are keeping the dads in line, right? Which is a good thing, okay? Most of us, our wives keep us in line, okay, to a point. But they make dads look like idiots. You know, they're wimpy, they're stupid, you know, they're goofy, you know, and everyone, every time a dad does something, the kids are going, oh, God, you know? And the dads look really silly, which that is not what dads are like. But you know that the enemy is doing that on purpose? He's destroying the men, the fathers. Why? Because if anything, all through the scriptures, it says that there was not enough fathers. And what do fathers do? Fathers father. Fathers equip, fathers train, fathers draw the children back home. The fathers are the ones that are supposed to be the strong ones. Yes, the mothers are. Now, moms, today, you know, we're not slamming. We're trying to build fathers up and put them in that rightful place. But fathers are there for that strength. Fathers are the one that they run to. Fathers are the ones that fix things. The kid's bike's broken, and hopefully the father can fix it. The sink's broken, he tries to fix it, then he calls the plumber. Okay? Fathers don't read directions. Okay? We don't have to. We get direct revelation from God on how to fix things, okay? If you really think about it. We just pray, how do you fix this? Thank you, Father, yes. You know, we go over and fix it. And then when we can't fix it, we read the directions. But dads are made that way. Dads are the ones that are to protect. Now look at The Godfather, not this picture, but think of the movie The Godfather. Isn't that what Don Corleone did? He fixed things, unfortunately not all the time well, okay? But he took care of things. He took care of the family. The whole family depended upon him. Right? Welcome to this. Now, here's the deal. What does godly mean? Let me show you a couple things. Now, in both Hebrew and Greek, okay, I'm not going to give you the words for it today, but I'm just going to tell you the definition. In both the Hebrew and the Greek, the word godly carries the same definition. It means this. It means a person acting in accordance with the requirements of God. Very simple. A person attributing to God those things which are right, which rightfully belong to him. It's reverence and worship emanating from a surrendered life. That's what godly means. Reverence and worship emanating from a surrendered life. Attributing to God the things that belong to him. What belongs to him? So we give it all to him. That's what a surrendered life is. Now, turn with me to Yeshua. Joshua, chapter 24, is right up there. We're going to hang on these two verses today. Now, let me give you a really, 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 really quick thing that's happening here. Okay? I'm just going to give you a brief summary of it. So at the very end of Joshua's life, okay, just like in Deuteronomy, Moses read the law for the second time to the people of Israel so they wouldn't forget. Because he says, I think it's in chapter 7 or chapter 6, he tells them he's doing this because when they get into the promised land, it's going to be so wonderful, they're going to want to forget God. Because everything's going good. Have we ever been there? Everything's going good. Money's good. Relationship's good. Everything's good. And we don't even realize that we're pushing God totally away because everything's good. And we think we don't really need him right now. And that's what Moses was telling in Deuteronomy, the people of Israel. Now, in Joshua is going to do the same thing. He's not going to read the law really again, but he's going to remind the people because there was something that went on in here. Now, let's look at it real quick, and we'll get to it. Now, therefore, fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and truth, and put away the gods which your fathers served beyond the river and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. If it is disagreeable in your sight to serve the Lord, choose for yourselves today whom you will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served from which were beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites, in whose land you are living. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Now, this is that scripture that probably you've seen in your life, a plaque that's hanging in somebody's house. It says, but as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Okay? And we've all seen it. And then you see him in Goodwill. Okay? Now, let me tell you something. Why we do this? Why today I'm calling us as fathers to this? Today there's a call, and it's to this. Why are we doing this? There's a very simple reason for it. In Revelation chapter 4 and Revelation chapter 5, it says this one phrase over and over again. He is worthy. He's worthy. We don't have honor like we used to have. You know, there was a time where you honored, like it says in Ephesians chapter 6, honor your father and your mother. But there was honor among that. And even in, you know, younger men to older men, we would honor them because they were fathers. Nowadays, go out anywhere and there's no honor. Kids aren't even honoring their parents anymore because they're into this new child rearing where it's like, they'll figure it out. No, they won't. You know, duct tape works great. Okay? I'm kidding. Don't go out here and go, that pastor feels like they just ought to duct tape all children. Only the bad ones. No, I'm kidding. Don't go out here. My friend of mine wanted to write a child rearing thing, how to rear your kid with a ball peen hammer. Bing, what are you doing? Don't do that. I said, no, that wouldn't go well. But we don't honor anybody anymore. We don't honor, we aren't raising children to honor, to say yes, ma'am, yes, sir, and that kind of stuff. But today, we're calling to honor God because he's worthy. Just because he's worthy to receive, it says to receive. To receive what? To receive everything.